I'm falling in love.
He phoned me and asked me if I would mind if he recorded The Wonder of You. I said, you don't have to ask permission. You're Elvis Presley. He said, yes, I do. You're Ray Peterson. Is sharing. As a student of the martial arts, he was physically strong. His technique was excellent, one of the best. He was a master entertainer and a master showman, but he was also a master human being. He demonstrated love and respect with sincerity and humility. In fact, Elvis taught me more than I taught him. I got to meet Elvis, an adorable, sweet Southern boy, as charming as he could be. No wonder all the girls fell all over him. He was as wonderful in person as he was on the screen. He didn't want to make some of those films at all. But you know, you have to do what you have to do. And now Elvis is gone. We're lucky we have what he did do. You've changed me, dear. This time it's true. Dan Thomason compared the reluctance of the presidential hopefuls to reveal their tax returns with the willingness of Elvis Presley to do so. Despite the fact that Elvis could have saved millions with legal loopholes available to him, he believed that it was the patriotic thing for him to do to pay for the privilege of his success.
Elvis Presley was a thrill for me to visit with. Not just once, but a couple of few times. And the way he treated my father, after I had met Elvis a couple of times, and then a time again he was performing in Las Vegas where my dad was visiting with me. And after the performance, we went back to the dressing room and I introduced my dad to Elvis, Elvis to my dad, and Elvis put a arm around my father's shoulder, took him over to a little couch and sat down, and they visited for the next bunch of minutes. And I was marveling at how kind, how nice, how respectful Elvis was at that time. I appreciated that big time, and I do to this day respect.
I think a lot of celebrities, when you find out what they're like, you're disappointed, and then all of a sudden you don't like them or their music anymore. I think Elvis was just the opposite. I think everyone who encountered Elvis, who liked his music, once they met him, they loved him more than they ever loved him.
Many times on stage, he would come over when he started to introduce me. And he would say, ladies and gentlemen, here's a man that I've known since I was 14 years old. He's the greatest bass singer in the world. And said, I never thought I'd get to share his stage. He said, thank you, J.D., for letting me share your stage. And I had about 2 feet, and he had, you know, he had the rest of the stage. But that's kind of a man he was, you know.
I walked up to him, and I looked at him, and I had tears in my eyes. I said, Elvis, I said, I can't believe that you called me out to sing in the middle of your show, and I'm an absolute nobody. And I said, I just can't believe it. And it kind of makes me fog up now to think about it. And he looked at me, and he hugged me, and he said, I'm not so big, I'm only 6'2". And it was quite an impressive thing to me to have that happen to me. And it made me feel such a part of what he was doing.
There was no difference between his image and who he was, except for that who he was even more important and bigger. Everything you saw that he had was what was there, what he gave, and he never lied. He never put up a front of any kind. He was who he was, and that's what came through, and his image didn't come anywhere near where he really was as a human being.
This is a man who contributed so much to our culture, to our history, to his audience. He only wanted to do good work. He only wanted to follow his vision and his passion.
What made that so incredible? Well, you know, it was the world's first televised satellite concert. I mean, Elvis was beamed around the world. It had never been done before. So it truly was one of those unique events. It was a milestone in television and music. And for Elvis, more people saw him in concert than man landing on the moon.
Wow.
And keep in mind, this is most people's experience of Elvis outside the United States. He never performed outside North America. So his exposure around the world, and today he still has this global popularity. It was truly a monumental milestone.
Sure was. Thank you.
pendant right
This here. Is a pendant that Elvis actually wore. This was given to Elvis by the Cooey Lee Cancer Foundation in Honolulu. He wore this during a show. It's Elvis in black onyx and surrounded by diamonds. So the concert was not only the world's first satellite televised concert, it was also a fundraiser. And so this was their gift to Elvis to say thank you.
Elvis was supposed to raise $25,000, but decided to let the people pay what they could afford. So with admissions and merchandise sales, they raised $75,000 for the Coolia Cancer Fund in honor of the singer-songwriter Coolia, who died of lymphoma cancer December 3, 1966. Elvis sang Coolia's song, I'll Remember You, in honor of him. Since then, there has never been another concert by a single artist that has attracted that much international attention. Obviously, only Elvis could push through something like that so single-handed with such an overwhelming impact and success, which today, 45 years after, still exists and persists. Elvis, who once received aid from the Commercial Appeal American Legion Christmas Basket Fund, never forgot that he was once hungry and needy. Therefore, after his 1961 discharge from the Army, he fulfilled his pledge in the amount of $105,000 to 39 charities who received checks during ceremonies held at the auditorium of the publishers of both the Commercial Appeal and the Memphis Press Scimitar. After adjustments made for inflation, the contribution is equivalent to $783,530.23 U.S. dollars in 2016.
We made wishes upon you. Love me always, promise always. Ooh, you'll remember too. I'll remember you.
Elvis Presley became a key supporter of Father Don Mowry's work, having grown up in Lauderdale Courts, one of the many Memphis housing projects well served by youth service during this period. Elvis's donations always came with a catch, namely that they never be put into a general operating fund, but instead set aside for special projects. By 1985, Father Mowry's national expansion of this Memphis-based concept is considered the most innovative social service effort between military and civilian sectors in the late 20th century. At that time, no one knew how much of an impact Elvis's contributions would have on the future of the organization. Much of the funding for this national expansion came precisely from that special projects fund that Elvis Presley had supported in the 1960s. In May of 1998, I went to Graceland. Everything about the place seemed awesome to me, but what struck with me the most from the visit was this particular story about Elvis. During a party at Graceland, Elvis was inside with a guest who came from a poor background, and the other partygoers were outside on the lawn. His friend commented on how sophisticated all the partygoers seemed. Elvis walked over to his desk, pulled out a stack of money from one of the drawers, opened a window, and threw the bills out the window. The partygoers scrambled after the bills, shoving each other, trying to grab as much money as they could. Elvis turned to his friend and said, "They're not that sophisticated."
Angel, angel, with those angel eyes, come and take this earth, boy, up to paradise.
Jerry Reed, country music singer and actor. First time I met him, I was blown away, and I just looked at him and said, "You're about the best looking thing I ever did see. Kinda wish I was a girl right now, Elvis."
If I said I love you, would I be speaking out of turn? I'm only human, but I'm willing.
Legacy Recordings, the catalog division of Sony Music Entertainment and RCA Records, acknowledge the astounding ongoing impact of the music and artistry of Elvis Presley to inspire, inform, and transform culture. I'm straight as an arrow, and I gotta tell you, you stopped whether male or female to look at him. He was that good looking. If you never knew he was a superstar, it wouldn't make any difference. If he'd walked into the room, you'd know somebody special was in your presence.
Let me kiss one tonight.
I said, why don't we turn out all the lights so we don't see this vast, empty-looking studio and make it as intimate as we can. We could barely make Elvis out through the glass from the control room into the studio when we cued him the backing track. And then Elvis started to sing. It was magic. Next thing I know, he's curled on the floor in almost a fetal position, singing with a microphone next to his mouth. The hair on my arms were standing up. And that's the take that we wound up using on the soundtrack album. It's rare when an artist's talent can touch an entire generation of people. It's even rarer when that same influence affects several generations. Elvis made an imprint on the world of pop music unequaled by any other single performer.
The whole love for Elvis began. It's his presence, I think it is. I don't think anyone in this business has had as much presence as Elvis. I don't think anyone's had as strong a presence. Like when Elvis walked in the room, everybody just looked at Elvis, you know. When he's on the screen, you looked at Elvis. You just had this thing about him. I just admired his presence, you know.
As long as I live, I know I will never see anyone have such a profound effect on people. He could make anyone feel like he was the most important person in the world just by talking with him. He had charisma and charm that is just indescribable, and he didn't even have to sing. When Elvis entered a room, you could feel the energy of his presence tingle at your nerves because the power of his magnetism was that intense, and Elvis was just as perplexed by this phenomena as you or I. He was a humble man, but keenly aware of his unique gifts, and spent most of his life searching the spirituality over and over throughout his life, asking himself, why me?
I become a puppet on a string, and you can do most anything with me. If you really love me, darling, please be kind. I offer you the truest love that you will ever find. Take my heart and please be fair. Handle it with loving care, for I'm just a puppet on a string, and you can do most anything with me.
Robert Fontenot, music historian and critic.
When they did a remix on A Little Less Conversation, and Elvis had the number one record in the world, I think it could happen.
He does sell more and more records. The album from a couple years ago, it's past 9 million, which is quite an accomplishment for someone that's been gone for 25 years, and he ends up number one in 26 countries. That's not bad.
Elvis Presley caught the public's imagination through two things. his unique ability to synthesize all American music styles, and his fantastic interpretive qualities as a vocalist. His charisma was remarkable, an unparalleled force that was stronger than any 10 other men in his peer group. He was the greatest. In fact, he was the most charismatic individual I have ever seen, both off and on the screen. He was the kind of person who could walk into a room and stop whatever was happening in that room. Every person, man or woman, would turn to look at him. He was that magical. There are no words in the vocabulary unless it is that he had magic. There's always me. No one could have that name and be ordinary. It is unique, rhythmic, memorable, and soulful, just like the man himself. It was the summer of 1975, and I was covering a World Football League game involving the Memphis Southmen. I stared at him. Yes, because he was Elvis Presley, but also because I had never seen a man that I would classify as beautiful until that moment, and I haven't seen one since. I felt there was a man there who truly cared about people, that his life was on a level that my life was not on. I was a snob. He tried very hard to make the film better. After a short period of time, he was disappointed, but he was too polite and well-behaved to say anything. I felt like he was younger than me, this very humble person who would make statements that he believed in. All I know is that there was a person there with a refined heart and soul. And I say refined on any level you want to look at it. When you meet someone like that, you know they're there. The essence of Elvis was as fine a person as I've ever met.
I went standby to Memphis from New York, and I was the 27th person on the standby list when I got on the flight. And I got there and went right to the place, and they just finished the viewing, the public viewing. But I met a guy who was like a media photographer fellow there, and I got to ride in the bus, in the press bus, right in front of the funeral cortege. Oh, and it was an amazing thing to see. Yeah. It was very hot, and there were just hundreds of thousands of people gathered underneath overpasses in the shade waiting for it. Yeah. It was very powerful. This is a long story. You got time?
Yeah.
I mean, and we already got to the funeral before the cars even pulled out of the Graceland. And the car turned on, never forget it, the car turned on and it turned, and it went down Elvis Presley Boulevard at about 3.5 miles an hour. And there was a riot at the gates of the cemetery.
Oh, people trying.
Because people trying to get in, they weren't letting people in. And I thought, this is something I got to see. I started running to see it, you know. And by the time I got there, all of a sudden, just as I came up on a hill, and all of a sudden this motorcade came out, and it was leading the hearse. And these cops looked at me like, move, and you're dead. Mm. You know, because it was just a nut running through the cemetery.
Right.
And I looked, and I was standing right at his mother's grave. It was really, really eerie thing that happened. But it was an amazing experience to see all the emotion, all the people.
But then there was this very strange moment when Priscilla actually left. Because you could feel Elvis. You could absolutely feel his presence everywhere. And when she left, it was almost like you could feel his real love went with her as she rode out of the cemetery. It was an amazing feeling. I'll never forget it. Well, you've got to have role models. He was an extraordinary guy.
There was a lot of buzz in 1972 about Elvis performing in New York. It was the first time he performed in New York, and the last time he performed in New York.
It was Elvis coming here to New York. I mean, no matter where you came from on the musical spectrum, you would have to have a sense that this was historic and imperative, and that it was almost beholden for you to be there.
When I saw that first glimpse of him, you knew it was going to be different.
he functioned as a god.
It's the world's most famous arena, probably the world's greatest stage. And I remember when Elvis came to the Garden, it was like he was arguably the world's most famous performer. It was just a spectacular event. It was probably to this day, with all the concerts that I photographed, maybe the number one concert that I've ever photographed in terms of passion, excitement, and charisma. Elvis was the king of charisma in addition to being the king of rock and roll. I remember when I went into the dressing room to see Elvis, aside from the charismatic lights that went off as you looked at him, as you spoke to him, you realized not only how shy he was, but how nervous he was.
Very seldom that you get a chance to go to a show at Mount Olympus.
I just couldn't believe the aura that he sent out.
He came on that stage and he owned it.
Gosh, you just never felt that kind of a vibe in your life. They went nuts.
Ronnie Tutt went into that long drum roll, and Elvis appeared as if by magic on the stage.
I was on the Ed Sullivan Show, and I did this song here. Excuse me, hold it. This is my message song for the night. You ain't nothing but... You don't know what I'm gonna do yet. Just wait a minute. You ain't nothing but a... But a... You ain't nothing but a hang on You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
Days and the electricity when you heard he was coming, and then you would wait and then he would enter the room and you could just feel the excitement backstage before the people in the audience even knew he was there.
When he walked in, it's like it's like royalty came in the room. I mean, everybody stopped.
In 2015, I met James Burton backstage at Delta State University in Cleveland before he took part in a Band of Legends concert which featured musicians and background singers who had performed and recorded with Elvis. Burton was Elvis's lead guitarist in the 70s. I asked Burton how he pictured Elvis if he were still alive. His answer surprised me. "An incredible gospel singer," Burton said. "And I would say a great gift to the young folks today to bring them to Jesus, to encourage them toward the Christian way. That's what I think."
Like most black people in the South, and to whose fruit God has pressed down a harp of 1,000 strings, it only needed tuning. Elvis's voice was that type of voice that agreed with the thought of Calvary. He had that kind of bent and inclination and attitude that suggested that God could use.
was a bundle of energy set to music. And that echo will never die.
People believe God is dead and Elvis Presley is alive. Really? I had a personal visit with Elvis Presley following his concert here in San Antonio years ago. Elvis had a deep sensitivity toward the Lord. He sold 600 million records, and that's a bunch. He received 3 Grammys, one for his life's work and 2 for his religious recordings. Those 2 songs were How Great Thou Art and He Touched Me. All those other songs, not one award. He had a tender heart toward the Lord, and he sang about heaven with a real passion that touched the lives of people, even through a record. I know some of you are going to start writing me a nasty letter for saying good things about Elvis Presley. Please, when you get to be perfect, then send me a letter.
I'm praying that you will have a spiritual experience that will cause you to lead millions of people to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And it was at that point that this moved Elvis. He was already in a spiritual mood, moved him in such a way that he began to weep. And his body, he began to tremble as weeping. And I grabbed his hands, and of course we all joined hands, and I had a prayer with him. I asked the Lord to give him peace in his mind, strength in his body, and also the Holy Spirit with peace in his soul.
I believe my own thing, just from knowing him, is that his spirit came through in the music, and so that's kind of what permeated whatever he did, and it would touch other spirits, and it's sort of on a different level.
Elvis came from a very special place of creativity. He did what he felt. He wanted very deeply to follow his instincts. He was just really following his soul.
Gospel was constantly going on ever since I can remember. I would beg him to sing How Great Thou Art, because that was my favorite when he would go into that.
The fact he got his first Grammy, believe it or not, with How Great Thou Art.
His bedroom was, you know, maybe 8 feet away from mine. There was always music coming out of there, especially 3 or 4 in the morning.
I remember being woken up, and I would go in there and listen.
He'd have, like, the Stamps up there, or his people come up, and they'd all start singing.
But he would have loved to have been in a gospel quartet.
They tell me that when I was about 3 or 4 years old, I got away from them in church and walked up in front of the choir and started beating time.
Attend church regular or anything like that.
He wasn't pretentiously religious.
But I'm a true believer of God, if that's what you mean.
Sharing life with Elvis, you got to share the whole spectrum, and spirituality was a part of it.
He was on a never-ending spiritual quest of some sort. I never not saw him reading, looking.
If he had a financial problem and he could work it out, he would give you whatever you needed for that. If you had an emotional problem, he would sit with you and he'd read a passage from the Bible. and talk to you, help you try to figure out your problem. And if you had a health problem, you know, he would try to work that out. If he had to send you to the best doctors that he could find, he would do that. If you had to have some kind of surgery, he would pay for that. So he took us, the three of us, and we went to the dressing area of our dressing room. And he said, let's pray. And as we prayed, he prayed, he touched Sylvia's stomach and he asked God to move whatever it was. Just take it away. And the next morning when Sylvia reported to Sunrise Hospital there in Las Vegas, they did the test and it was gone. Whatever it was, whether it was a misdiagnosis or whether God had healed Sylvia through Elvis' faith and our faith, I don't know. But we believed, and Elvis believed also, that God had worked a miracle through him.
He was very conscientious about giving his audience everything that he could every time he went out on a stage. And he was so concerned because he was having a little vocal problems because of the flu. And so just at time for the curtain to come up, Red and Sonny usually brought him down to the stage, and they were standing there, and he had slipped off from them. And it was time for the curtain to go up, and they were frantically searching for him everywhere, and 2001 Space Odyssey music, whatever it was coming on, and we were all doing our high screaming and singing out there, and Elvis was nowhere to be found. And they finally went to the men's room, and he opened the door of the men's room, and there he was, and he was in there kneeling down, praying, and asking God to help him to be able to touch his fans with the music on that particular night, because he always wanted to give them everything that he possibly could. And he was asking God, God, help me to give them everything that I can. He was almost like a preacher when it comes to that, wanting to minister to the people only with his music.
And it wasn't so much what we did, it was what happened in the room, the atmosphere, how it changed from one setting to this unbelievable setting with cold chills on your arm, you know. And I kind of used that in my analogy of the Holy Spirit sort of came in there, and it sort of dwelt among us, and we really began to live the words instead of singing the words. It kind of came in there and saturated us and made us all equal. I think that's the thing, it equals us all out, because when Elvis started singing, you knew he meant what he was singing. He meant those words. Elvis is singing today. You got JD singing bass. And he's got some wonderful people with him. And if we'll be good boys, then we'll get to sing back up again with him. And then we'll never lose again.
I'd like to ask J.D. Sumner and the Stamps to sing one of my favorite songs, Why Me, Lord?
Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do to deserve loving you? And the kind.
By the early 1960s, only half of the total goal of 500,000 had been raised, so journalists from Hawaii reached out to newspapers across the country for support. Elvis Presley was inspired and decided to put on a show in remembrance of the men aboard the Arizona and veterans as a whole. There were 4,000 available seats for the show, 100 VIP ringside seat tickets, which sold for $100 apiece. Using values adjusted for inflation, a VIP ticket cost nearly $800 in 2016 dollars. All the profits were to be used for the construction of the USS Arizona Memorial. Over 3,000 people greeted Elvis upon his arrival at Honolulu International Airport. The concert alone raised $52,000, which was 17% of the total goal for the memorial. While it wasn't enough to completely fund the construction, the performance spread awareness about the fundraiser, with an additional $10,000 being personally donated by Elvis and Colonel Parker. Today, people visiting the Arizona Memorial can see the plaque that thanks Elvis and his fans for their contribution to the monument, which was dedicated and built over the next year. The Arizona Memorial today is a symbol of the men aboard the USS Arizona who now stand eternal watch. Attracting over 1 million visitors annually, the Arizona Memorial makes for an exciting morning of activities. On April 3, 2017, Jim Watson, Mayor of Ottawa, announced, "Whereas Ottawa has the unique distinction of being just one of three cities outside of the United States where Elvis Presley had a live performance, April 3rd shall henceforth be known as Elvis Presley Day in the capital."
Fantastic. Thank you. I'd like to do one of my favorite gospel songs.
Budapest Mayor Esteban Tarlos, as published in The Guardian, 2012. Elvis Presley was named a citizen of Budapest and a park named after him because he was a champion for those amongst our people who turned against our country's Soviet-backed government in October 1956. The International Red Cross handled some 26 million Swiss francs sent by his fans, which they distributed to the thousands of Hungarian families affected by the Soviet invasion in both Vienna and London, where the refugees were allowed to settle. And although the revolution was squashed, Presley saluted the uprising in January 1957 during his last appearance on the Ed Sullivan Show and performed Peace in the Valley, a gospel standard, as a tribute to our plight. At his request, Sullivan solicited the TV audience to donate towards our relief efforts, raising $6 million in U.S. dollars, or the equivalent in 2012 to $49 million, or about 26 million Swiss francs.
My lips touch you with their song.
The boy had everything in the way he looked, the way he talked, the way he acted. He really was different. God intended for Elvis Presley to do what he allowed him to do. That's why he made him so good looking. I used to get close to him, try to find fault, but not. He moved an awesome mountain that set in the way for people like me who might never have gotten anywhere. And he was my friend. Gabriella Rossi, Director of Gardens and Grounds at Monticello, Thomas Jefferson's former home. When I think about my family, I listen to André Roux, a violinist and conductor who is very popular in Europe. But when I think about living like it's my last day on earth, I listen to Elvis Presley. Rob Nude's Law of Presley's Selling Power, even in 1961, when using the first electric watch to ever have been made. Nowadays, with the cult of celebrity so firmly ingrained in Western society, it seems obvious that having a leading star flash their wrist at a large audience would see a brand's sales go through the roof. But when Elvis Presley wore the Hamilton Ventura in the 1961 film Blue Hawaii, the then American brand couldn't have imagined the enduring effect of Presley's contribution. No, the grass won't pay, no mind. Based on our company's recent growth, his items have resonated with shoppers, with overall sales in the previous 52-week period ending January 22, 2017, advancing 26% as a result of sales of products bearing his name alone. His is one of the fastest growing segments in the beauty industry. Now all our friends are leaving, so we'll be alone. General Colin Powell. There was a real threat of danger, a Cold War with an iron curtain, and there was a Soviet army stacked up on the other side. So those were serious times. He wasn't just another soldier. He was Elvis Presley. But unlike others who have gone in the military from celebrity life and essentially used their talents to entertain troops, he was a scout. When I first met him, he was out in the field and he was recognized for his professional performance in the 3rd Division, and it occupied the shallowest part of the NATO battle front. We were both in that division, and we had the toughest job, and it was a time of heightened tension. We were in this wooded area, and when I walked over to him, he saluted and was very proper. He acted, and I saw him as just another soldier in the woods, kind of dirty, doing a job. Albert Prince of Monaco. He was an extraordinary figure of his and our time. His legacy is tremendous in terms of the music he created, his films, and as an entertainment personality. The generosity that he showed toward others is simply remarkable, and I think it's these aspects of his character, his persona, that make him such a special person.
And when I hear you whisper your mind.
Few people in history can truly be considered legends, but in the case of Elvis Presley, the label rings true.
Cause this is our dance. Darling, remember, it's our dance. Loving and tender, I'll take you away. Take you away in my arms. Oh yes, this is our dance. Now we're together for our dance. Can last forever and nobody knows just what tomorrow.
The people he touched are as diverse as humanity itself, and because of that, his popularity has transcended race, class, national boundaries, and culture. There is no simple answer about why that is so. All I can say is that he had that magic. People today should see him not simply as a performer, but as an artist with a great soul.
If should go.
UK billionaire Richard Branson's ideal dinner party, September 30th, 2016.
Please say that
Winston Churchill would add wisdom, war stories, and outrageous comments. English mathematician and early computer developer Ada Lovelace would be one of the 6 guests. Elvis Presley, one of the greatest entertainers of all time, and an example of people with great talent, along with Nelson Mandela, would bring magic to the evening.
Each time the star falls out.
So what it boils down to was Elvis produced his own records. He came to the session, picked the songs, and if something in the arrangement was changed, he was the one to change it. Everything was worked out spontaneously. Nothing was really rehearsed. Many of the important decisions normally made previous to a recording session were made during the session. It was actually a look to the future. Today, everybody makes records this way. Back then, Elvis was the only one. He was the forerunner of everything that's record production these days. Consciously or unconsciously, everyone imitated him. People started doing what Elvis did. The budget is $269 million, and Mont Petit thinks it will finish under budget. We're in the middle of a resurgence in the capital. and called the old train station part of a cultural landscape, a national landscape that once saw soldiers leave for war and return years later, and one that welcomed Winston Churchill, the Emperor of Japan, and Elvis Presley.
In my
arms. On April 13th and 15th of 1999, Australian astronomer John Broughton discovered two small planets. He named one planet Elvis and the other Rock and Roll.
Kiss by me. Kiss by me. When I'm with you, I don't know.
Elvis Presley was an explorer of vast new landscapes of dream and illusion. He was a man who refused to be told that the best of his dreams would not come true, who refused to be defined by anyone else's perceptions. This is the goal of democracy, the journey on which every American hero sets out. That Elvis made so much of the journey on his own is reason enough to remember him with the honor and love we reserve for the bravest among us. Such men made the only maps we can trust. Stephen Miller, at a political rally on May 25, 2016, at Anaheim, California, on the subject of how best to define and defend American culture. Our culture includes Elvis Presley, Jimmy Stewart, John Wayne, Frank Sinatra, Bing Crosby, Johnny Cash, Jackie Wilson, Theodore Roosevelt, Douglas MacArthur, Milton Friedman, Edgar Allan Poe, F. Scott Fitzgerald, Thomas Edison, and again, for emphasis, Elvis Presley.
I'm falling in love tonight. Somehow I know.
A few months before the United States Postal Service's announcement regarding the first Elvis stamp, Ralph Nader said, "The Postal Service is being wasteful in spending nearly $300,000 to promote its Elvis Presley stamp. To break even, they would have to sell more than 1 million stamps to collectors who do not then use them." The stamp netted $36 million U.S. dollars in profits, its highest ever, as a result of some 124 million stamps being purchased and kept by collectors, more than a third of those 500 million originally issued and sold. B.B. King. I remember him distinctly because he was friendly, polite to a fault, spoke with this thick, molasses southern accent, and always called me sir. I liked that. When he appeared at the Goodwill Review, a yearly benefit for needy black kids sponsored by WDIA, he did himself proud. Remember, this was the 50s, so for a young white boy, by then a big star, to show up in an all-black function in 1957 took guts. Elvis didn't steal any music from anyone. He just had his own interpretation of the music he'd grown up on. Same was true for me. The same was true for everyone.
Yeah, well, see, at first he was playing more like rockabilly. He wasn't really getting into the things that he started to do later. But when he started to do that, then he started turning heads, including mine.
Yeah, it did. So
yes.
What did you see then?
I saw that he had everything. The looks, he had the talent,
he had the rhythm,
he had the soul. He had everything. To me, he had everything. You know, you start looking at the guy, he's handsome, he's tall, and he looks good, he can sing, he can play.
Don't you know that now?
He's a champion who has lived and kept the title. He's for real. Elvis is a southern child that is down to earth. He's beautiful, just beautiful. I thank God for Elvis Presley. I thank the Lord for sending Elvis to open the door so I could walk down the road. You understand? He was God-given, an integrator, a blessing. They would not let black music through. One of the sweetest gentlemen, and he could sing, especially gospel.
I will understand, believe me. I can't help but love you, but believe me.
The meeting at Graceland between Japanese Prime Minister and President and Mrs. George Bush virtually became the only private home in America other than the White House and any of the presidential retreats to host an official meeting between a sitting president of the United States and the head of a foreign government.
There's nothing left to feel.
I managed to get 6 tickets. The show was memorable for the music, and his voice was strong, but he looked tired and not well. A few months later, Elvis was back. This time, his voice was even stronger, but he looked worse. 2 months later, he was dead, and that's when my family and I went to see him one last time. In a memorable trip where we and thousands of others walked slowly through those gates to view his grave. That show was free.
Praise nobody. You didn't deserve it.
Recently, someone asked the question of who had been the one individual who had helped save the most money in the U.S. healthcare industry in the last century. The answer, surprisingly, is Elvis Presley. On October 28, 1956, Elvis got a polio vaccination on national TV. That event was responsible for raising immunization levels in the U.S. from 0.6% to over 80% in just 6 months. No other single individual has had that kind of impact on healthcare in the United States. Dr. Stephen Maudsley, University of Cambridge historian, in a film titled Teens Against Polio, described how the activities of a group of teenagers against polio in the 50s America, spearheaded by Presley, if studied, may 60 years later inspire the effectiveness of pro-vaccine public health information campaigns. The growing trend among parents not to have their child vaccinated is reflected in the current rise in the number of outbreaks of vaccine-preventable diseases. Perhaps the U.S. healthcare system could use another Elvis Presley. Director David Lynch, who recently voted the 1968 comeback special as his number one musical performance of all time. He was falling in the ratings and it brought him right back onto the throne. And when you watch him sing in Baby, What Do You Want Me to Do in particular, which is a cover of an R&B song by Jimmy Reed, Elvis makes it his own. You see, this music is him. He's got every inflection, every feeling, 100% out there for all to see. It's so thrilling to watch. It's infectious. With singers and musicians, there is the surface of something and then the real deep levels of being it. And nobody gets close to Elvis because he gets that thing at the deepest level and it comes alive with him and everybody feels it. And it's like magic. He looks so great in his black leather, but even if he looked weird, he'd still be the king. Elvis is the total package and he was born for it.
He's a man in New Orleans, he's a rock and roll, he's a guitar man with a great big soul. He lays down a beat like a ton of cola. He goes by the name of King Creole. You know he's gone, 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 jumping like a catfish on a pole. Yeah. You know he's gone, 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 out of hip-shaking King Creole. The king starts to do it, it's as good as done. He holds his guitar like a tommy gun. He starts to growl, put out in his throat. He bends a string and that song she wrote. You know he's gone, 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 jumping like a catfish on the pole. You know he's gone, 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 out of hip-shaking King Creole. He sings a song about a crawdad hole. He sings a song about a jelly roll. He sings a song about a pork and greens. He sings some blues about a New Orleans. You know he's gone, 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 jumping like a catfish. Yeah. You know he's gone, 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 and a hip-shaking King Creole. He plays something evil, then he plays something sweet. No matter how he plays, you gotta get up on your feet. When he gets a rocking fever, baby, heaven sings. He don't stop playing till his guitar breaks. You know he's gone, 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 jumping like a catfish on the pole. Yeah, you know he's gone, 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 and shaking King Creole.
Placido Domingo said, I loved his music. He could sing anything. He could sing spirituals, country and western. Everything he sang, I liked. Elvis Presley did a lot before he passed. I don't see how he did it. You'd have to stay up day and night. And he was a nice fellow, shy. His face was so pretty, so soft. A little before 10:45, he came to the gospel classic, How Great Thou Art, and that was it. As he came to the part where he belts out the title, he sounded like Mario Lanza with soul, cutting loose a series of high notes that would tingle the spine of even the diehard skeptic. Crescendo came on a song called Hurt. It's an old song that Elvis didn't record until a couple of years ago. And the key ingredient is its range, an awesome collection of notes that could leave a normal set of vocal cords in shreds. He finished in what seemed his most potent style, but wasn't satisfied and mumbled to the band, let's do that last part again. He did, and if there was anyone among the packed house crowd who had thought Elvis was a fluke, they no doubt came away converted.
Inolvidables como la escala en que la lluvia de la loma en las axillas hasta se ocupa.
Bill Porter, RCA's foremost recording engineer, explaining to Michael Farmer how Are You Lonesome Tonight came into being. With the lights totally turned off at Elvis's insistence so as to create the best atmosphere possible, but without Porter knowing about it. Steve Schultz, who produced the session, said, "Roll the tape." And I said, "But I haven't heard the song yet." And he said, "Roll the tape, Bill." And I looked, and the studio is totally black out there. I can't see a thing. I said, "You're kidding." He said, "No, roll the tape." So I roll the tape, and I don't know what's going to happen. And a guitar starts off, and then a bass comes in, and Elvis starts singing. And I still can't see a thing in the studio. And I'm afraid to turn any mics off because somebody might come in and start playing. All of a sudden, Elvis stops singing and just starts talking. And I say to myself, "This is awful, because you don't normally put a lot of echo on dialogue." And I thought, next take, I'll just turn it down. So we just did the take all the way through. If you listen to the dialogue, the echo matches the effect, because it says, "And the stage is bare and I'm standing there." Later I said, "How about that echo?" Schultz said, "Forget the echo, it's a hit." And it was done in one take.
I asked him one day, "What makes you pick out your songs?" He said to me, "I want to be able to reach and feel what we all go through as human beings."
This is the mysterious part about music. How do we know when we're listening to a song that someone means it? We just know. And the people who mean it are generally the ones who are processing some kind of loss through music. And we can hear them negotiating their loss, and we connect to it.
Then they go on living without you. Now the stage is bare, and I'm standing there with emptiness all around. And if he won't come back to me, then they can bring the curtain down.
Is your heart filled with pain? Shall I come back again?
Even today, it seems like I remember everything about him, especially how he defined the myth and monument of the culture of contemporary expressionism. He invented everything and led a ship which we could all board, and led many to sing everything when all we would have done without him is sing boleros. He was rock and roll, is today and shall always be tomorrow. God bless Elvis Presley. Terra, a Spanish online publication's views on the power of Presley's voice, and it's being ranked as one of the 10 most imposing in the history of recorded sound. The latter in conjunction with a celebration of the Day of Voice, and published in their online page on April 15, 2015. Elvis Presley transcended his being called the King of Rock and Roll, even the music he made famous, in favor of his later becoming one of the 20th century's greatest cultural icons. But it is his versatile voice and his unusual delivery of numerous musical idioms, as well as the attraction he held physically and sexually, that led him to being the greatest solo artist in the history of popular music. The Scotsman, review of the album Love. There comes a point when his voice starts to wash over you. You get inside of it, start to really hear what he's doing, and you realize his singing has this extraordinary, effortless quality to it. Sometimes it's like listening to a stream of honey. It's a very smooth ride, the voice of Elvis Presley. I don't think you focus on the words when he's singing. I think he's doing what bel canto singers do. You don't listen to the words, just to the beauty of his voice. When I say just, that makes it sound as if he's denying you something else. But actually, that's quite enough. Nick Patrick, co-producer with Don Reedman for both If I Can Dream and The Wonder of You. As with the first time we stepped into this amazing world, it is the extraordinary intimacy of Elvis's vocal performances that is truly breathtaking. The exquisite and effortless way he takes us on an emotional journey with him, through delicate sensitivity to power and grace, all within a magical 3-minute song. I can honestly tell you that every single time Don Reedman and I played each song, it really did feel as if we were listening to a private performance held just for us in our own home. Our home is the Abbey Road Studio, and we were listening to the greatest artist that ever lived.
I offer you
anywhere in the world, not before, devotion, during, or after, has there been a bigger music star than Elvis Presley. I always wanted to record one of his ballads, but in English, and I chose the title track for his second movie, Loving You. Elvis was a gospel singer par excellence. On Milky White Way, 1960, he's got the strength of a bassman and the sweetness of a tenor. The heritage we have in Elvis's gospel music is a gift to the world.
From the moment our lips first met,
Elvis was the most exciting stage performer who ever set foot on the stage. Everyone who worked with him has confirmed that Elvis's vocal range has never been equaled, even when Elvis's health problems were the most dramatic. If you listen to the CBS 1977 concert, which aired after Elvis died sadly, Elvis's talent and vocal range is almost a spiritual experience, touching something wonderful inside our soul and leaving its imprint for all time. Elvis Presley took the talents God gave him and shared them with the world, and gave us his time and did so with grace. Donald Rumsfeld, former Secretary of Defense, as cited in his memoirs, after his show, Sammy Davis Jr. said he would arrange for my wife Joyce and I to go see the best entertainer in Las Vegas, which, considering Sammy's fame, was quite a compliment. Once at the show, the audience was enthralled as the singer sang songs of every genre, and that evening I became a fan of Elvis Presley. Even today, particularly on Sundays when we do not get to church, Joyce and I listen to Elvis singing gospel songs.
God bless the day I found you. I want to stay.
In the 50s, listening to Elvis on the radio in Bombay, it didn't feel alien. Noises made by a truck driver from Tupelo, Mississippi, seemed relevant to a middle-class kid growing up on the other side of the world. That has always fascinated me. It was the first cultural phenomenon that was about, for, controlled by, and made by young people. And your mother didn't like it, though she got used to it eventually. In fact, I think Elvis was the one who got to her. Mike Hanley, narrator and TV radio spokesman. When healthy and serious, he was flat out the world's greatest singer. In his voice, he possessed the most beautiful musical instrument and the genius to play that instrument perfectly. He could jump from octave to countless other octaves with such agility without voice crack, simultaneously sing a duet with his own overtones, amen, an always lurking atomic explosion to so effortlessly fondle and release the most delicate chimes of pathos. Yet those who haven't been open or had the chance to explore some of Presley's most brilliant work, the almost esoteric ballads and semi-classical recordings, have cheated themselves out of one of the most beautiful gifts to fall out of the sky in a lifetime.
Time we meet, love, I find
He had an incredible, attractive instrument that worked in many registers. His equipment was outstanding, his ear uncanny, and his sense of timing second to none. In short, he could sing. And when it came to the blues, Elvis knew his stuff, his knowledge being almost encyclopedic. Mike Stoller and I were blown away. In fact, the conversation got so enthusiastic at the studio that Mike and Elvis sat down at the piano and started playing four-handed blues. He definitely felt our passion for the real roots material and shared that passion with all his heart. Just like that, we fell in love with the guy. "Let's get started," Elvis said, and then we jumped right into Jailhouse Rock. Greg Sandow, music professor at the Juilliard School. I suppose you had to call him a lyric baritone, although with exceptional high notes and unexpectedly rich low ones. But what is more important about Elvis Presley is not his vocal range, nor how high or low it extends, but where its center of gravity is. By that measure, Elvis was all at once a tenor, a baritone, and a bass, the most unusual voice I have ever heard. Brian Gilbertson, world-famous voice teacher, explaining the deepness of Elvis's lower registry. "I don't really think Elvis's voice was significantly lower than those of any other baritones. The color of his voice and the sense of warmth and richness of tone gave the sense that the voice was much deeper. Elvis, in fact, did not force his lower register comfortable as he was with it, which in turn gave the impression that it was lower than those of other baritones. People will often say that opera singers sound too stiff and operatic when singing contemporary music. This is because the vowels in operatic style tend to be more open, whereas in a rock style, singers tend to thin out the vowels. Opening the vowel in a higher register allows the higher notes to be sustained. Elvis Presley was very open in his singing style, even though he was the rock and roller. Bono, lead singer of U2. Elvis was already doing what the civil rights movement was demanding, breaking down barriers. You don't think of Elvis as political, but that is politics, changing the way people see the world. In Elvis, you had the whole lot. It's all there in that elastic voice and body. As he changed shape, so did the world. His last performances showcase a voice even bigger than his gut, where you cry real tears as the music messiah sings his tired heart out, turning casino into temple. I think the Vegas period is underrated. I find it the most emotional. James Champion, in his book, The 25 Most Influential Americans of the 20th Century, published in 1996. Had Presley never sung a note, he might have still caused a stir. But sing he did. His jagged, bubbly highs and southern baritone jumped from those recordings like spirits from a cauldron. Elvis crooned romantically, then screeched relentlessly, always pouring his heart into the lyric and melody. After Elvis, the male vocalist could no longer just sing a song, especially in the new world of rock and roll. The feel of the performance far outweighed the perfection of the take. The China's Post review of the album Wonder of You is a new twist on a very familiar and treasured body of work. This one is a tried and true concept, basically a variation on last year's quite successful pairing of Presley's vocals with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. But it is a reminder of Presley's range and vocal dexterity. The orchestral style suits Elvis well. The orchestra is restrained and understated, allowing Presley's vocals alone to carry the day. It gives rise to the series of six live British concerts at major arenas this fall, with Elvis singing on screen while the Royal Philharmonic performs. it is expected to draw thousands of the faithful. The number doesn't seem to be dwindling, even 39 years after the death in a country, the UK, where he never performed.
Listening to his vocals, there's not one note that's out of pitch. There's not one phrase that's not shaped and rhythmically and melodically beautifully sung.
I have to say I had some very good scenes with him in Loving You, but I found myself going to every shot, every scene in which he sang, because I was completely taken by listening to him sing. I could not believe the charisma. Incidentally, my uncle was the opera star Mario Lanza. I knew what it was like to encounter not just an actor or a singer, but somebody that you knew was going to be a legend. Mario was going to be the next Caruso, and Elvis, I thought, he's in that class. This man is going to live forever, because that voice is not just for us, but for the people of God.